Danielle Dixie here. Today I want to talk to you about more of a back to the basics type topic, and that is planning a backpacking trip. Not long ago when I did the Back to the Basics of Backpacking 2-week series, somebody asked in that series, how exactly do you go about planning a backpacking trip? Now I know obviously for the more experienced people who have already been out on several backpacking trips, this is kind of a no-brainer. And although we do some more advanced topics on this channel, I do think it's important to always kind of return back to the basics. That way folks who don't really have any experience backpacking can get started. So today I want to cover some of those logistics and things to think about when you're planning a backpacking trip. Of course, every backpacking trip is a little bit different. Some people stay gone for a weekend, some people go out for a thru hike, which could be up to a 5 to 6 month trip. So the center of your backpacking trip and the way you design it is probably going to be determined by how much time you have off and how much time you want to spend on trail. If you only have the weekend, then you might not go anywhere real far away from home. You might want to do a local trail. But say you have a week or maybe even a little more than a week off, then it might be worth it to you to travel across the country and backpack in a different state, because that way you have the extra couple days for travel time. Once you determine the general area that you want to hike and you kind of narrow in on a trail, then you really want to start researching that area. You need to get maps, check out apps that may be available for smartphones for that particular area. You can join Facebook groups that are dedicated around that trail. For example, the AT Appalachian Trail, Pacific Crest Trail, Continental Divide Trail, the Pinhoti Trail, which is in Alabama, the Vermont Long Trail, etc., all have dedicated Facebook groups where people can exchange information and help one another out when planning trips to those areas. So even though you might be planning a trip on a trail that doesn't get quite as much traffic as those trips, you might be surprised to find that there is still a dedicated group on Facebook or a forum on the internet in general that might have a lot of information for that particular trail. If you can find blog posts or articles where people have documented their journey on that particular trail, I find those to be definitely very helpful. It's a good idea to find out what time of year is best for backpacking in that area weather-wise. For example, if you're going to go on a hike in Florida, then probably late fall, during the winter, and even early spring would be prime time, so that maybe the mosquitoes aren't quite as bad and the heat definitely isn't as bad. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you've got the White Mountains in New Hampshire, where you definitely don't want to go backpacking there in the wintertime unless you're more experienced with actually mountaineering in wintry conditions. So the Northeast might be somewhere you want to backpack, say in the middle of summer when you've got the warmest temperatures and you don't really have to worry about snow and ice. Now obviously this would work best if you have complete flexibility of when you can take your time off. If you only have specific time off, so say you're a teacher and you're going to go backpacking in the summertime, then you might have to flip that around and pick the areas that are best to hike in the summertime. You can check online for average weather temperatures for a certain area and make sure that especially your sleeping bag is rated for whatever temperatures you're going to experience on the low range. I would suggest to set yourself up for success by going backpacking for the first few times in an area where the temperatures aren't going to be below freezing. That way you don't have to stress out about hypothermia as much. You can still get it when you're in warmer temperatures, but putting yourself in a situation where the temperatures are going to be below freezing is going to increase that chance. And then also, you're putting yourself at risk of having a miserable time if you haven't had the chance to test out your sleeping bag and lower temperatures yet. So again, make sure that your sleeping bag especially is rated properly and set yourself up for success by going in a temperature range that you think you'll be most comfortable in. Another thing you need to consider is permitting. The area that you go backpacking and or camping may require permits. This is especially true in national parks. Because national parks are higher traffic areas, they tend to fill up a lot faster. So like the Smoky Mountain National Park gets a lot of visitors, Yellowstone. Those areas you need to make sure that you book as far ahead of time as you can. It's not really something that you can necessarily plan last minute. I'm not saying that it's not possible, because sometimes there are cancellations, but just make sure that you plan these things as far in advance as you can if you're going to an area where a lot of people backpack. Different areas have different food storage requirements, so it's important that you find out what the requirements are for the area that you'll be backpacking. Some areas may say it's okay to hang bear bags. Some areas may require bear canisters. Then also some areas may have designated bear boxes that you can store your food in. Now, if you're thinking, well, I'm not gonna go backpacking in bear country for the first time I go, so I don't really have to worry about this, there still may be requirements for the area that you're going, even if you're not in bear country. And you'll likely still need to take some sort of precautions to deal with mice, coyotes, or other critters that think that your food might be better than what they can forage for. Now you've figured out where you're going, you've got your gear, you know the time of the year that you're gonna go, and now how do you get to the trail and how many days do you plan for? So let's talk about some of those logistics. First, you want to estimate how many miles per day that you're gonna do. I know that when you haven't gone on a backpacking trip yet, it can be hard to estimate how many miles per day that you're gonna do, but this is really gonna depend on the weather. So is it gonna be pretty rainy on your first trip? I would actually, unless you've bought plane tickets and spent a lot of money on reservations to go to a specific area, I would avoid hiking in the rain to start with. Again, you want to set yourself up for the best success, and having fun and being in good conditions is best practice for that. However, if you've already planned for an area and you know that it's going to rain, then you might want to scale back what you think that you might do on mileage, because you might just get sick of hiking in the rain and decide to set up your tent or other shelter and just kind of enjoy being at camp instead of hiking a lot of miles. The terrain will obviously also play into this. So if you're used to going day hiking in areas like Florida that are pretty flat, and then suddenly you're hiking up at higher elevations and climbing to passes and then back down into valleys, you're probably gonna do a little bit less miles than you would in the flat terrain that you're used to. If you have no clue how many miles you'll be able to do per day, then just take your gear, load it into your pack, throw some food and water in there, walk around at a local park on a day hike, even if you have to go around your neighborhood, just to get some kind of estimation of how many miles that you could do comfortably per day. Over time, you'll learn what kind of hiker you are. Some people like to take it slow and smell the roses, take lots of breaks, and just really take it all in. And some people are faster hikers, and they want to cover as much new ground as possible and see everything that they can in one trip. A lot of that will depend, again, on the terrain that you'll be hiking in and your physical abilities. Some people out of the gate can do about 15 miles. Some people do more like 4 to 5. Me personally, when I've started all three of my through hikes, I've started at about 8 miles per day is what's comfortable. We talked about food storage, but now let's talk about food and water a little bit more in detail. In general, the rule of thumb that people usually say is a good amount of food per day for a backpacking trip is 2 pounds per day. Now, of course, everyone is going to be different on this, but that's a good number to start with if it's your first backpacking trip. I find that when I first start out, I'm not as hungry as when I've been hiking for months at a time. So 2 pounds per day is probably a little bit more than I would take if I was just going out on a weekend trip or even a week-long trip. I tend to be not hungry when I first start out, but some people may get out there and be really hungry and wish that they had more than 2 pounds per day. But if you start with that number, then for your next trip, you'll probably have a better idea of what you prefer. As far as how many days of food that you want to carry while you're out in a stretch, I usually don't like carrying more than about 5 days of food. That becomes really uncomfortable for me. I have carried up to about 8 days of food, but if I'm going on a trip that's gonna last longer than that, then I'll probably scout out resupply points. So either a road crossing that I get to where I can hitchhike to a town, or maybe a trailhead where I can arrange for a shuttle to come get me, go into town, and then return to that point. So for your first trip, I think it's a good idea to start with a lower number, maybe 1 to 3 days of being out in the wilderness. But as you get more experience, I would say 5 to 8 days is really probably a good number for a max amount that I want to carry at one time. And after that point, I'm going to be looking for resupply options. Now let's talk about water. You want to have some way to treat your water. And again, if you check that link to the playlist for that 2-week series, I have a whole video about water treatment in there so you can figure out which filter or chemical, etc., is right for you. But you want to make sure that you have something to treat your water. But more importantly, you need to verify that there are running water sources in the area that you will be hiking. This will likely be more of a concern in the heat of the summer. So again, if you check out forums online or Facebook groups dedicated to those specific hiking trails, sometimes there are even water logs that people volunteer and keep up, so that way hikers know that they'll have access to water. Worst case, you might have to find access points along the trail if that's possible and cache the water for yourself. But I think it's best to go on a trail when you're first starting out that you know will have plentiful water sources, because you don't really want to get in a pinch and end up being dehydrated and potentially putting yourself in a really bad spot. For some of the more popular long distance trails that you could go out and easily do a section on, there is an app called Guthook that I've mentioned a lot on this channel. Hikers leave notes in there on the waypoints that mark water sources to let each other know if the source is still running or if it's dry. Now let's talk about access points. This is also something that you can scout out in an app like Guthook, if your particular trail is listed in Guthook, or maybe the All Trails app, or even just checking out aerial photographs online. But usually if a road intersects a trail and there's a trailhead there, in general, you can find parking. So depending on the number of miles that you're going to be doing per day and the number of days that you want to be out there, you should look for 2 access points that will have that distance between them. One resource that I'll suggest is the Homemade Wanderlust Backpacking Forum group. I've also mentioned that a lot of times on these videos. It's a great resource. We have over 30,000 members now all over the world, a lot in the US. So if any of y'all are eyeballing certain trails, then chances are that somebody in that group might have experience with it. So you can always check out that group and ask questions there if you can't find a designated group for the specific trail that you'd like to do. Once you have everything else figured out, now you have to decide, well, how am I gonna get to the trailhead? If you want to, you can drive, and if there is a parking area at one of the trailheads, you can always leave your vehicle there and either hitchhike once you get to the end and your second access point, and then hitchhike back to your vehicle, or you can always drop your vehicle off at one trailhead and then hitchhike to the other trailhead and hike back to your vehicle. If you are going solo and you don't like the idea of hitchhiking, which I completely understand, then you can always do an out and back trip. So you park your vehicle at the trailhead, go north as far as you want to, and then turn around and come back. A lot of people seem to not like the idea of that because they feel like they're not getting to see as much. You know, they're seeing the same trail for half the time. But honestly, a lot of times the trail looks completely different in the opposite direction and you get to see new scenery. Occasionally when I'm hiking, I like to turn around and look in the opposite direction and think, what would this trail look like if I was heading the opposite way? So in that instance, you'd get to enjoy it in both directions. If there are 2 or more people in your group and you can have 2 vehicles, then you can always have 1 vehicle at either trailhead. That way, when y'all hike back to one car, you just drive to the other one. But say that you're going solo and you don't want to leave your vehicle parked at one of the trailheads unattended. Sometimes there are hostels in the area with high traffic trails, so you can see if they have shuttle services. Maybe you stay with them the night before you start your trip and leave your vehicle parked at the hostel, and then they can shuttle you to the trailhead and arrange to pick you up when you get finished. Or there might even be designated shuttle services in a certain area nearby your trail. And again, you might can leave your vehicle parked with them. I know a lot of them offer that to people because they know that folks are driving in and they don't want their vehicle left at a trailhead. And if it's one of the long distance trails that has a larger community around it, chances are there might be a trail angel that could even help you with transportation, picking you up or dropping you off at trailheads. There may even be a motel in the area that you can stay at and ask them, hey, if I end up Ubering to this trailhead, is it possible for me to leave the vehicle in your parking lot and pay for leaving it there, or maybe they won't even make you pay because you're staying before you start your trip and once you get done with your trip. And they might say, sure, park it up here near the office and we'll try to keep an eye on it for you. Regardless of where you leave your vehicle, I would definitely recommend not leaving anything valuable inside of it, because even if somebody has the best intentions of protecting your vehicle for you, they definitely won't be able to guarantee that, and you don't want to lose anything this valuable. And then there's always the option of just using public transportation and not worrying about having your vehicle parked somewhere unattended. All right, y'all, well, that is all I have for you today. Hopefully this video helps you cover the bases as you prepare for the logistics of your first backpacking trip. For those of y'all who are more experienced that hung in today as I was talking about this, if you have any other tips for people that are planning their first backpacking trip, you know, that you remember being useful for you when you planned your first trip, please feel free to leave that in the comments below. And if anybody watching today either has an area that they really love to hike in and they're very familiar with all the logistics of that area, leave a comment that states that specific area or trail and let people know that they can ask you questions if you don't mind. And for those of y'all who are wanting to backpack in a certain area but are unfamiliar with it, then feel free to leave that in the comments too, and maybe the folks in this community can share some information with one another and help more people get out and enjoy backpacking. If you found this video useful or you like the content of this channel, don't forget to subscribe before you go. Thank y'all again for watching, and we will see y'all next time.